Welcome to a special edition of Larry King Live. The North American Free Trade Agreement, a deal to knock down trade barriers between Mexico, Canada, and the United States. Good or bad for Americans? Tonight, Vice President Al Gore meets Ross Perot as Larry King and CNN present the NAFTA debate. Now from Washington, Larry King.
Good evening. We need to tell you off the top about some ground rules that have been agreed to by the Vice President, Mr. Perot, and CNN. We have no studio audience here. Neither the Vice President nor Mr. Perot have any staffers in the studio, nor may they talk with any assistants during the telecast. No representatives of either side are in the control room while we are on the air. Our guests may use notes, visual aids if they wish. We have no debate clock. This is no formal statement and rebuttal format. There's no time limit on questions or answers. The program will go 90 minutes. To be fair about deciding who got to sit where, we tossed a coin earlier today. Vice President won and chose the inside seat. Viewer calls will be screened and chosen by the producer of this program, who will make every effort to assure balance. The call-in number in the United States is 202-408-1666. Overseas, 202-408-4821. 202-408-4821. We'll give you those numbers again later. We'll start with the Vice President. We're going to wing back and forth and then include your phone calls. When President Bush signed this in San Antonio, he was on our show, and then a few nights later I was with you and the then-governor, now President-elect Clinton, asked about this, NAFTA, and the President said, to the best of my memory, well, I'm basically for it. I want to see the side agreements. Mm-hmm. I want to hear what the unions object to. And then I'll come back and sort of let you know. But it was not a definitive yes. What changed?
Well, we negotiated two side agreements that protect labor and protect the environment. And not until the two side agreements were completed did we agree to support NAFTA. Now, this is a good deal for our country, Larry. And let me explain why.
But you were hedging early.
Well. We said from the very beginning that we wanted to improve the basic arrangement, which we did with these side agreements. And the reason why this is so important can be illustrated by the story of a good friend of mine that I grew up with named Gordon Thompson, who lives in Elmwood, Tennessee, with his wife Sue and his son Randy. He makes tires for a living. He's a member of the United Rubber Workers, and he's for this because he's taken the time to look at how it affects his job and his family. We make the best tires in the world, but we have a hard time selling them in Mexico because they have a 20% tax collected at the border on all of the tires that we try to sell. Now, when they make tires and sell them into the United States, the tax at the border is zero. So it's a one-way street. NAFTA changes that. It makes it even Steven.
So he'll make more tires.
Well, his job will be more secure. They'll make more tires. They'll be able to sell more tires. His son will have a better chance of going into that line of work if that's what he should decide he wants to do. And remember this. I mean, people think, well, they don't buy tires. Mexico bought 750,000 new cars last year. The big three sold them only 1,000 because they have the same barriers against our cars. Those barriers will be eliminated by NAFTA. We'll sell 60,000, not 1,000, in the first year after NAFTA. Every one of those cars has four new tires and one spare. We'll create more jobs with NAFTA.
Weren't you a free trader always, Ross?
I am a free trader now.
Do you favor some sort of NAFTA?
Absolutely.
And what's your rub?
The problem is, this is not good for the people of either country.
Either
the McKeeler, yes. I think the important thing for everybody watching this show tonight to remember, this is not an athletic contest. This is not a question of who wins, whether I win or the Vice President wins. This is a question of do the people of the United States and the people of Mexico win. Now, that's the important issue, and I'm sure we're in agreement on that. My concern is very simple. I look at many years' experience in the Maquiladora program, and here is what I see. We have a lot of experience in Mexico. I've been accused of looking in the rearview mirror. That's right. I'm looking back at reality. And here is what I see after many years. Mexican workers' life, standard of living, and pay has gone down, not up. after many years of having U.S. companies in Mexico, this is the way Mexican workers live all around big new U.S. plants. Now, just think, if you owned a big U.S. company and you went down to see your new plant and you found slums all around it, your first reaction would be, why did you build this plant in the middle of slums? And your plant manager would say, oh, there were no slums here when we built the plant. You say, well, why are they here now? They said, this is where the workers were.
Your agreement would have been a different NAFTA, right?
This would be a NAFTA that gives the people. Now, what are the rules here? Did I answer his questions or yours?
Well, mine or both. This is freewheeling.
Okay, but the point being, this is, there it is. Here it is on a more personal basis. Livestock in this country and animals have a better life than good, decent, hardworking Mexicans working for major U.S. companies. And here's one just to look at. Here's a good, decent man working his heart out, making his cardboard shack, and the cardboard came from boxes that were used to ship the goods down there.
Can I say something about this?
I didn't interrupt you.
Okay, now, guys.
Now maybe it just...
Is this... Yeah, now, your concept would have been what, Ross? If this was a bad...
All I'm saying is if after 10 active years, this has been in effect since the 60s, but let's say 10 active years, you would think the standard of living of the Mexican worker would begin to come up. Instead, it continues to go down by design. 36 families own over half the country.
So
85 million people work for them in poverty. U.S. companies, because it is so difficult to do business in this country, can't wait to get out of this country and go somewhere else, and, if possible, get labor that costs 1/7 of what it costs in the United States.
How would you change it?
Very simply, I would go back and study. First, we should look at this. It doesn't work.
Well, what specific changes would you make in it?
I can't, unless you let me finish, I can't answer your question. Now, you asked me, and I'm trying to tell you.
Right. Well, you brought your charts tonight, so I want to know what specific changes
that's
you would like to make
question.
in the treaty.
If you're against it, let them respond.
How can I answer if you keep interrupting?
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Okay. Now, first, study the things that work. The European community has had a similar experience. They got to Spain, Portugal, countries like that, where the wages were different. People didn't have rights, so on and so forth, and they made them come up the economic scale. In 1904, Theodore Roosevelt wrote a beautiful, simple statement. And basically, he said something very similar to what Congressman Gephardt recently said. He said, under no circumstances can we lower the standard of living of the working American. Therefore, any trade agreement we enter into must require a social tariff, I would say, that makes it an even playing field, then gives Mexico an incentive to raise the standard of living of its people, which it does not have now.
Okay, can I respond now?
The standard of living of
okay.
People.
Okay. Now, so your basic response is you would change it by raising tariffs.
I just started, but you interrupted.
On Mexico.
That's the first thing
one
I would
by
do.
One.
The right. First thing
first
I would
okay.
Do.
Now, I've heard Mr. Perot say in the past that, as the carpenter says, measure twice and cut once. We've measured twice on this. We have had a test of our theory, and we've had a test of his theory. Over the last 5 years, Mexico's tariffs have begun to come down because they've made a unilateral decision to bring them down some. And as a result, there has been a surge of exports from the United States into Mexico, creating an additional 400,000 jobs, and we can create hundreds of thousands of more if we continue this trend. We know this works. If it doesn't work, you know, we give 6 months notice and we're out of it. But we've also had a test of his theory.
When?
In 1930, when the proposal by Mr. Smoot and Mr. Hawley was to raise tariffs across the board to protect our workers, and I brought some pictures too. You brought some pictures?
Is a protectionist?
This is a picture of Mr. Smoot and Mr. Hawley. They look like pretty good fellas. They sounded reasonable at the time. A lot of people believed them. The Congress passed the Smoot-Hawley protection bill. He wants to raise tariffs on Mexico. They raised tariffs, and it was one of the principal causes, many economists say the principal cause, of the Great Depression in this country and around the world. Now, I framed this so you can put it on your wall if you want to.
Thank you.
Would raising tariffs produce another...
We're talking totally different, unrelated situations. you do need to measure twice and cut once. But then if you have a program that is failing, you should not institutionalize it. See, the Mexican program has failed. It's failed the people of Mexico. It's failed the people of the United States. These numbers they give of exports from the United States are not realistic numbers. For example, they count in the government figures automobile parts going into Mexico to be put into cars made by U.S. car companies in Mexico and shipped back to the United States to be sold as if Mexican consumers bought those parts. That didn't happen. Then if you take a, let's just say you have a piece of glass crystal that you spend $100 making it in this country, you're going to send it to Mexico to have $10 of additional work done to it. They count it as a $100 export. Then they count it as $100 coming to Mexico from the U.S. Then they count it as a $110 import back in the United States. Now then, when you look at how they count, the real export figures to Mexican consumers are tiny. The used factory equipment coming from U.S. factories going into Mexico, new factories going to Mexico.
Are not bought?
No. It's a Zenith moves equipment from the U.S. into Mexico. That's used equipment. Then we count that as if Mexican consumers bought it. Nobody bought anything. Old equipment just came to Mexico.
Let me respond to that if I can, because unfortunately, there's a grain of truth to that, but it's so tiny that it's not a half-truth. It doesn't quite rise to that level. There are a few things in that category, but the vast majority, 80 to 90%, are exports that stay in Mexico and are bought there. Here's what's happened to our trade surplus, and these figures are net figures. It takes into account everything that he's talking about in that small category. In 1987, before Mexico started lowering its taxes at the border, its tariffs, we had a $5.7 billion trade deficit with Mexico. After 5 years, the goods we make and sell into Mexico, the volume has been growing twice as fast as the goods they make and sell in the United States. So last year, we had a $5.4 billion trade surplus. Now, if that trend continued for another 2 years, and NAFTA will, by removing those barriers, greatly accelerate it, we will have a larger trade surplus with Mexico than with any country in the entire world.
Why are trade unions so opposed to it then?
Well, some of them.
I mean, if you're a friend who makes the tire, and he's a union member, is going to benefit from this. Why is the unions aligned with Ross Perot? Why do we have this alignment of Ross Perot, unions, Jesse Jackson, Pat Buchanan, and Ralph Nader?
Because some of them make the same mistake that, with all due respect, Mr. Perot makes. They confuse the bad trade deals in the past with this one, which is the first time we've been able to get one that's even Steven, with zero taxes on both sides. You know, I told you about my friend Gordon Thompson. The international president of his union opposes NAFTA. Gordon Thompson has taken the time to look at the facts, and he supports NAFTA. Let me tell you who else has taken the time. Every living former president of the United States in both parties, the two-termers and the one-termers, every former secretary of state, every former secretary of defense, secretary of treasury, every living Nobel Prize winner in economics, conservatives, liberals, everyone in between, they've never agreed on anything.
Wait,
let me just finish this one point. And distinguished Americans from Colin Powell to Tip O'Neill to Rush Limbaugh, Ross Perot Jr., the head of his business, Morton Myerson, Orville Swindle, the head of United We Stand last time, and Ross Perot Sr., supported it until he started running for president and attempting to bring out the politics of fear.
Ross?
Will I be able to speak
for a second or two from time to time? You're on.
Because there's a lot of inaccuracies here. Let's go to the big picture and skip the personal stuff. People who don't make anything can't buy anything. Let's start with that. We are 85% of the market. Canada is 11% of the buying power.
Of the total three markets.
And Mexico is only 4%. People who don't make anything cannot buy anything. Never forget that. Now then, let's look at these exports. See, here's Mexico 4%, Canada 11%, United States 85%. We're the biggest buyer of goods and services in the world. Please remember that tonight. That's one of our aces. Now then, here's the real export story. You get down here, these are the phony exports down here. Here are the real exports here, about $7.7 billion. You take this thing into pieces, you take this big number here, and take it right down to here, and that's what you're really talking about. And just remember this. If you want to trade, you trade with people who make money. You don't trade with people who oppress their workers and they don't have any money. Now, it's true. A good deal will sell itself, folks, just plain talk. Four former presidents came out for it and couldn't sell it. All the secretaries of state came out for it and couldn't sell it. We had satellite going across 200 auditoriums across the country. That didn't sell it. Got Lee Iacocca for it. That didn't sell it. $30 million coming out of Mexico, and that is rotten, and that is wrong, and that didn't sell it. $30, $35 million coming out of corporate America to try to get out of this country, go south of the border, and hire that cheap labor, and that didn't sell it.
Let me know.
This dog just didn't hunt. Now, today they don't have the votes in the House of Representatives. We're in the third quarter. They can get them because they're buying them big time with your tax money. We're working the halls night and day to make sure it doesn't happen. You can play a key role in it. But sure, they all tried to sell it to you, and the fact that they couldn't demonstrates that this deal is not good for our country.
Let me get a break, and then, but it doesn't impress you that every former president supports
it? It impresses me that they couldn't do it.
Oh, but it doesn't impress you that they support it.
That they show, those are the guys that cut the worst trade deals in history. He's already talked about
it. It's not over with.
Wait just a minute now. They did the Japanese deals. They did the Chinese deals. God bless them. They cost you 2 million jobs. 2 million jobs.
You think they fooled Colin Powell?
He's a great soldier, doesn't know anything about business.
We'll have the vice president respond with Vice President Gore and Ross Perot after this.
But he could.
We're back on Larry King Live. We'll be going to your phone calls in about 15 minutes, and we're going to cover as much of this as possible. We're going to be getting to jobs and other aspects of it, but I want the vice president to respond to Mr. Perot, who's made some charges here that this is being bought.
Well, all of them, there's been more money spent against the NAFTA than for it, for sure. You can just look at the commercials. Every dollar that has been spent lobbying for it has been publicly disclosed. That is not true on the other side, and I would like to suggest to Mr. Perot. I think it would be a good idea, seriously, if you would publicly disclose the finances of your organization lobbying against it. They have not released the money spent, the contributors, where it's coming from, how much of it is Mr. Perot's, where the rest of it is coming from. But there was another statement I wanted to respond to also, and that is that Mexico doesn't buy a lot of products, that they're too poor to buy a lot of products. There's a big misunderstanding in the minds of some people about that. They are buying a lot of products. In fact, they're our second largest customer for manufacturing goods. They will be one of the largest customers overall if the trends continue. They already are. 70% of everything that they buy from a foreign country comes from the United States because we're so close to them and because they prefer our products.
And this treaty would increase jobs here?
Oh, no question about it.
Because there was an announcement today that it would be minimal either way.
There have been 23 studies of the impact of NAFTA on jobs in the United States. 22 of them have shown that it will cause an increase in jobs in the United States. The one that didn't showed that there would be a decline in illegal immigration, and they counted all of the illegal immigrants as holding jobs, and when they were taken out of the picture, they said that was a decline. Everybody else says it increases jobs in the United States.
On those points,
okay,
Ross.
Government studies are kind of like weather forecasters before balloons even, and certainly before radar. Now let me give you three. Now we're back down to common sense. Number one, you remember in the tax and budget summit when they said, watch my lips, no new taxes. Then they gave you a big tax increase, and they told you if you would pay it, they would balance the budget, pay off the debt, and we'd live happily ever after. See, now then, the new president had to raise taxes again because that one didn't work, and you picked up the difference. Now let's go to Medicare. When Medicare was first conceived in 1965, I'm talking about government forecasts.
Well, can we talk
about
NAFTA?
Excuse me, Larry, I don't interrupt. May I finish?
No, but he did. He brought up a specific point.
Could I finish?
Yeah, but of course.
I'm saying all government forecasts. How come the facts are
Well, I don't want to sit here and listen to you just take shots at President Clinton on other subjects.
Well, excuse me, I haven't taken a shot at it. He wasn't here in 1965.
Well, you know, but you talked about
the tax and budget summit, and we're proud that we did. The tax and budget summit occurred before he became president.
Yeah, you went on from that. Why don't we talk about NAFTA?
Excuse me, all I said was he had to raise taxes again. That's hardly a cheap shot.
Well, on the wealthy.
Back to the point.
That's the campaign promise.
Let's try to stay on point. I agree.
But
first, are you spending more money than the other side?
Larry, I would really like to finish. I don't interrupt him, and if I could finish.
Okay.
Let me give these two examples. We talked about the inability to forecast the debt, right? And the fact that we have to keep paying more taxes. Then when Medicare came along in 1965, they said it would cost us $9 billion in 1990. It cost us $109 billion. Then when Medicaid came along, they said it would cost $1 billion in 1990. It cost $76 billion in 1990.
Meaning that you don't trust any government forecast?
I'm saying they basically come out with phony numbers. He's talking about these exports.
You're saying that the forecasts on NAFTA are phony.
Yes. Then let's take the next one. We say that we're spending more money against NAFTA than they're spending for it. That is not even close to true. It is a matter of record how much Mexico has spent. It is a matter of record how much USA NAFTA has spent.
Why isn't it a matter of record how much you all spend? Can that be a matter of public record? Can you release those numbers?
I really would appreciate being able to speak.
All right. Well, it was a question
really
you raised.
That's a fair question, isn't it?
Excuse me.
I raised it earlier.
It was my understanding tonight we'd have a format where you would ask the questions.
Okay.
I am not able to finish.
But if he makes a statement, I'm just trying to balance so that he answers yours and you answer his. Okay, go ahead.
I would like to finish a sentence.
Okay.
Just once before the program's over. Now, we are not able to buy time. If you are anti-NAFTA, you cannot buy time on the networks. We have had to go buy local station time. We cannot buy network time because the networks won't sell it. That covers on how much you're spending. We didn't run 10-page supplements in the New York Times, et cetera.
Okay, now I'd like to respond to that. Okay. All right, go ahead.
By the way, I do want to respond. For the benefit of both of you, our time is equal. You both have spoken equally tonight in time. We're keeping time in control so that we're fair.
All right, and on the manufacturing goods, second largest manufacturing good, they send all this phony turnaround stuff and count it as though we sold it to Mexican citizens. People who don't make any money can't buy anything. When you look at the Mexican worker and you go to the Miami Herald and you look at the man who works for Zenith in Mexico and you compare him to his counterpart who works for Zenith in the United States, this poor man makes $8.50 a day. You know what his dream is? To someday have an outhouse. Do you know what his big dream is? To someday have running water. Do you know why these people are desperate for running water? Because Mexico ignores the pollution and environmental laws.
But this is not without NAFTA.
Excuse me,
but this is the prelude to NAFTA. They have strong environmental laws that they don't enforce. Now, just one second.
Let me respond to that, and then we'll have to finish.
Okay. First of all, you will notice, and the audience will notice, that he does not want to publicly release how much money he's spending, how much money he's received from other sources to campaign against NAFTA. I would like to see those public releases the other side has made. Now, let me come to the point that he talked about accuracy of forecasts and numbers. I watched on this program, right here at this desk, when the war against Iraq was about to take place, and you told Larry King, this is a terrible mistake because it'll lead to the death of 40,000 American troops. You said you had talked to the person who had ordered the caskets. You were wrong about that. You said on Larry King just before the election that after Election Day there would be 100 banks that would fail, costing the taxpayers $100 billion. You were wrong about that. Now, the politics of negativism and fear only go so far.
Right,
you started out
I gotta
as
take
the
a break and I'll have Ross yeah. respond. We'll come right back on Larry King Live.
You'll have to fool with okay. it, and I'll be happy to.
We'll come right back on Larry King Live. We've got a lot to go. Your calls, too. Don't go away. We've been around the fringes here. I want to get to jobs, but we'll have the Vice President finish his statement, then Mr. Perot respond, and then we'll get to some specifics and your phone calls.
Well, you're getting to the key issue there, because Bill Clinton and I were elected to do something about what's happening to working men and women in this country.
Correct.
They've been losing their jobs. There has been unfair competition from foreign countries that don't let our products in, even though we buy their products. This will help to stop that. Some people want to stay with the status quo, just keep things the way they are. We want to open up these barriers. And let me give you a specific example. Valmont Electric Company in Danville, Illinois, less than a year ago, was trying to sell products into Mexico. They've got a 13% tax at the border. We have a zero tax coming the other way. They closed down in Danville, 400 jobs lost. They opened up in Mexico with 100 jobs down there, and now they ship their products duty-free back into the United States through the Alliance Airport, which is the free trade zone that Mr. Perot's company has set up for. It's kind of a private free trade zone outside of Dallas, and they take Valmont Electric's products and distribute them through the United States duty-free. Now, if we passed NAFTA, that 13% tax that they have at their border would be gone, and companies like Valmont could stay here in the United States, sell their products in Mexico, and not have to go down there to get over the barrier.
Are you saying that Mr. Perot is personally benefiting by attacking NAFTA?
I think he has set it up so that he will benefit financially either way. But if NAFTA passes, I mean, if NAFTA is defeated, this family business that has a free trade zone outside of Dallas will continue to distribute products coming from Mexico into the rest of the United States. What is the deal with the alliance?
I think what you mean, I'll explain it, but okay. What we see here tonight is why our country is $4 trillion in debt, going $1 billion in debt every working day. Nobody ever focuses on the real problems. Now, I'm going to try to say this as simply as I can. Alliance Airport is in Fort Worth, Texas, not in Mexico. Alliance Airport is owned by the city of Fort Worth, not my son. Can you shake your head on that?
No. The
Alliance Airport, check the FAA, is owned by the city of Fort Worth.
You don't have
the
ownership
airport,
of
the airport.
Of the Alliance Carter Incorporated?
Please.
I'll let him finish.
Please. Let's have an unnatural event and try not to interrupt me.
Okay.
Now, my son owns land adjoining the airport. Now, the purpose of that land is to build factories and warehouses to be so that industrial goods can be moved by rail and by air. Just now, watch my lips. The jobs will be created in Texas. Texas is in the United States. The workers will be United States citizens. They will be paid U.S. wages. It is a job creator in the United States of America. And all of this other silly putty they throw up, for example, the free trade zone concept goes back to the 1930s. It is nothing new about the free trade zone concept. You have to apply to the U.S. government to get it, and if it didn't make sense, I guess they wouldn't have given it to him. But it is not aimed at doing business with Mexico.
Mexico
will be a tiny little part of this whole operation. Okay. I am putting my country's interest far ahead of my business interest.
You would do better with NAFTA?
When I'm in a room with corporate America, the first thing they say is, Perot, why don't you keep your mouth shut? You could, with your resources, make more money than anybody else. Here is the NAFTA game. Buy U.S. manufacturing companies cheap right after NAFTA passes that are labor-intensive, that make good products, that have marginal profits. Close the factories in the U.S., move the factories to Mexico, take advantage of the cheap labor, run your profits through the roof, sell the company stock at a profit, go get another one.
That's what they do now. That's what they're doing right now.
Are they doing that now?
And they're using Alliance Carter Incorporated in part to do it.
You're talking about something like a trickle of water coming over Niagara Falls as opposed to the gusher. You know it.
Now, you say it's
now,
your son's
do
business.
Do you guys ever do anything but propaganda?
Isn't
do
it you, your business
would
also?
Would you even know the truth if you saw it?
Oh, yes.
I don't believe you would. You've been up here too long.
Let me ask you a question.
Please let me finish. This is not crossfire, is it, Larry?
No. Go
May
ahead.
I finish?
And then I'd like to ask a question.
All right. I have tried to explain with countless interruptions that this creates jobs in the United States. I am extremely proud of what my son is doing. I want to answer the question that he jumped in to ask. I own a minority interest in the airport. This, everything I'm doing makes it next to impossible for my family to ever do anything south of the border, and I could care less. Okay?
You do no business in Mexico.
I have no, look, I will put my country's interest in front of making money.
Let me know when I can
respond. And I don't ever want to make money at the expense of other people. See, now, I got interrupted a minute ago when you shifted it back.
One other thing.
No, I'd like to respond on this before we leave it.
The financing of the anti-NAFTA campaign. You had not been asked it, and he asked it.
Okay, fine. I'll answer it. See, again, he throws up propaganda. He throws up gorilla dust. It makes no sense.
What is the thing?
May I finish? Yeah. Okay. Most of the television time I bought during the campaign, that is a matter of public record. I have had two television shows since the campaign in the spring. They cost about $400,000 apiece. Those are network shows. Then we just did a NAFTA show, but we have to buy the time locally. I don't have the figures yet on what that cost me. I'd be glad to tell you.
You're spending.
I had to buy it. No. I buy the television time because I don't want to take the members' money for that. They understand that. They approve of that.
Okay? So it's your money.
Can I respond? Well, it's not all his money, and we don't know.
No, the television
because they do
time,
not.
I just told you.
Well, but see, they do not release the records. But I accept your response because you have said that now.
If it makes you feel better to see the checks and the bills from the network,
it's okay for you to interrupt, but not me.
Okay, all right.
Now, hold on. You just said that you would.
Jobs.
You just said that you would release the records, and I appreciate that. Now,
this has nothing to do with what's going to happen to our country. Like
well, we need to know who's trying to influence it. Now,
I am paying for it. Is that simple?
Okay. We got the answer, guys.
Okay.
He's
now,
banned.
Now, on this, this alliance business is connected to the jobs issue.
Why is it important?
Well, because right now we've got these barriers that we cannot surmount to sell into Mexico. We have been trying for years to get an even relationship so that their tariffs, their barriers, their taxes at the border will be eliminated. A lot of companies now have an incentive to leave the United States and locate down there. We heard about auto parts. Right now there is a 13% tax at the border collected by Mexico on U.S. auto parts. Wait a minute, let me finish. This is important, Larry. And there is less than 0.5% tariff the other way. That big growing market down there, in a few years they're going to be buying 1 million cars a year. In order to sell into that market, these companies now have an incentive to pull up stakes and move down there. This business, which is not just his son's business, and there's nothing dishonorable about it at all, but here is the brochure for it, and here is the prospectus, and here are the two principal, what look like the two principal investors there, Mr. Perot and the American Eagle. And in the prospectus it says see it there?
Okay, now.
And in the prospectus it says that this is an ideal national distribution center for products coming out of Mexico. Plus, he has lobbied the taxpayers to spend more than $200 million in taxpayer funds in this project.
Who is
that
he?
Takes you and your business.
I'm not lobbied anybody.
There's nothing illegal about it.
I haven't done it. I have not lobbied anybody.
You've never hired a lobbyist?
In my life? You mean on the airport?
Both.
No, on the airport.
On the airport.
No, I don't hire lobbyists. This is my son's project. I went to the air show been out there. Probably been 18 months since.
What's the relevance?
Well, the relevance is that if the free trade, if the NAFTA is defeated, then
what?
This free trade zone that he has is still in business. If it's good enough for him, why isn't it good enough for the rest of the country?
He's doing this for personal profit?
I said before that I think that he is in a position to benefit either way. And he was in favor of NAFTA, again, made speeches in favor of it, wrote in favor of it in your book before you started running for president. You started getting a response from
okay,
people.
Let's ask this fairly. What turned you against it if you were in favor of it?
Well, conceptually, I am for free trade. I am, if we ever get back to the subject, for a good agreement with Mexico. I am deeply concerned about the 85 million people who live in poverty and don't have any rights. I am deeply concerned about workers who, when they go on strike, U.S. companies call in goons, bring in the state police, shoot several workers, kill one, injure dozens, put the workers back to work, and cut wages 45%. Those are things that are wrong. We can do this right. I am not in favor of a one political party country. The PRI runs the country. President Salinas will pick his successor. President Salinas went to the 36 families who own over 54% of the gross domestic product and asked them for $25 million apiece. Fortunately, one of them leaked it to the New York Times and they didn't have to pay. That's Mexico. He will pick his successor, not the Mexican people. Read the State Department's annual report on human rights of journalists being killed, people in the opposing political parties being put in prison and killed and tortured. This is not a free society, and yet for some reason the same people who are willing to put our troops at risk around the world to make sure people are protected, once we get to Mexico, ignore all of it.
Are you saying this supports a fascist kind of state?
I'm saying this is not, I'm concerned any agreement we do should give the Mexican people a decent life, and over a period of time should give them some purchasing power. If I'm going to do business with somebody, let's just say, if the U.S. is going to do business with another country, let's do business with a country whose people can buy things. Let's go to a big buyer.
President Salinas is a progressive.
President Salinas is almost out of office. I'm worried to death about who follows him.
Can I respond?
When you treat people the way they treat people, it's a matter of time until they lose power. Now, they've had it for a lot of years, and they keep it by force, but whether it's labor and management or countries and people, you oppress people long enough, and you get a change, and that will happen.
Let me respond to this.
Because
some of what he's saying here is true. Mexico is not yet a full democracy. They do not yet have full protection for human rights. They do not yet have the kind of living standard and labor standards and environmental protection standards that we would like them to see. But they've been making tremendous progress, and the progress has been associated with this new relationship to the United States. The decisions in Mexico will ultimately be made by the people in Mexico. The question is whether or not we will have the ability to influence what they and their government decide. The best way to eliminate our influence down there is to defeat NAFTA. The best way to preserve it is to enter into this bargain, continue the lowering of the barriers. We've got a commitment that they're going to raise their minimum wage with productivity. We've got an agreement for the first time in history to use trade sanctions to compel the enforcement of their environmental standards. As they begin to develop and locate better jobs farther south, we cut down on illegal immigration. Now, one of the reasons why all of the living former presidents and the other folks that I mentioned are supporting this is because this is the kind of choice that comes along only once every 40 or 50 years. This is a major choice for our country of historic proportions. Sometimes we do something right. The creation of NATO, the Louisiana Purchase, Thomas Jefferson did the right thing there, the purchase of Alaska. These were all extremely controversial choices, but they made a difference for our country. This is such a choice. If we should happen to give in to the politics of fear and make the wrong choice, the consequences would be catastrophic. If we make the right choice, we have a chance to encourage Mexico to continue on the path they have been traveling.
Ross is not saying he wants the status quo. He wants a different treaty.
Am I
correct?
He wants to raise tariffs on Mexico.
Just a second. Let's look at reality as
opposed to theory. And then we'll take our first call. Go ahead.
Let's look at reality instead of theory. There's a major U.S. chemical plant in Mexico that digs holes in the ground, dumps the chemical waste in those holes, bulldozes over those holes, and contaminates the water supply for the people in that area. A disproportionate number of the babies born in the shanty town around that plant are born without a brain. Now, I don't care if you're poor or rich. if your baby is born without a brain because a U.S. company is willing to take advantage of workers to that extent, that's wrong. Now, if there's any question about it, the xylene, the chemical xylene, in the water content in a ditch coming out of that plant is 53,000 times the amount permitted in the United States. This outfit, big Democratic group backing the Democratic Party, here's the videotape that shows them digging the holes, putting the chemicals in the ground. It shows one child whose foot is horribly burned from chemicals, and it shows the classic worker abuse. I pass it on to the Vice President.
Yeah, thank you. I agree.
Because I know he cares. I'm not trying to play gotcha with you.
I agree with you on this.
I know you care deeply about these things.
Yeah, can I answer you?
I know you're a good man, but the laws are on the books. They're not enforced.
Yeah. And NAFTA would what? Change them, not change them?
Well, they have this little side agreement, but the facts are Mexico is so sensitive about its sovereignty. They're not about to let us go down there and get into the middle of their Rio Grande River. All right, folks, Rio Grande River is the most polluted river in the Western Hemisphere.
Let him respond.
Tijuana River is the most they've had to close the
beaches. But all this is without NAFTA, right?
Yeah, let me respond to this if I could, would you?
This is after years of U.S. companies going to Mexico, living free.
But they could do that without NAFTA.
But we can stop that without NAFTA, and we can stop that with a good NAFTA.
How do you stop that without NAFTA?
Just cut that out. Pass a few simple laws on this.
Simple laws on Mexico?
No.
How do you stop it without NAFTA?
Give me your whole mind.
Yeah, I'm listening. Okay. I haven't heard the answer, but go ahead.
That's because you haven't quit talking.
Well, I'm listening. How do you stop it without NAFTA?
Okay. Are you going to listen? Work on it. Yeah, very simple. Just tell every company south of the border, if they operate that way, they cannot ship their goods into the U.S. at any price, period, and they will become choir boys overnight. See, Mexico is a country that can't buy anything. Japan, everybody else in the world is going to flood into Mexico if NAFTA is passed so that they can get cheap labor to flood the U.S. market.
I got to get a break.
Environment.
When we come back, I want to respond to this.
Then we'll go to your phone calls on Larry King Live. We'll be right back.